here tonight. Praise the Lord. We're going to have a time with our bluegrass gospel singing family. Hallelujah. From Canada. All the way from Canada. They come down here in the States and bless us and sing for us and just minister to us through the Spirit of God. And we've had a wonderful lunch together and fellowship. And we so enjoy having them every year. So welcome back. Let's stand and worship the Lord. We're going to have our super Sunday night service. Hallelujah.
It's better in the game, I'll tell
you. Yes, we got a super Holy Spirit that's here tonight. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Shutout is happening right now. Yeah. And Houston, if you don't want to know the score, we won't say. I'll tell you what, though. One team that is wearing red is winning. They both wear red. Yeah, but it has some red on it.
Jesus, for this awesome time to be together, Lord God. Oh, you've ordained it, Lord Jesus. Oh, God, you've met us here, Lord, with your precious Holy Spirit, Lord. God, we pray that your will would be done here tonight, that your name would be lifted up, Lord God. Your name would be heard, your name would be sung, your name would be praised, Lord God. Oh, we praise you tonight, God. We give you the glory, Lord. Anoint the Johnson family. I pray that you give them every heart's desire, Lord, that you'd meet their need, that they would have no lack or want, Lord. I pray for our church tonight that we would receive from you, God, and hear from you, Lord. And we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Have your way.
You will. Let's go to sing. Let's sing. I'm going to keep on singing because I am going to stop for nobody and nothing. Hallelujah.
I'm going to keep on singing. Going to keep on shouting. Keep on lifting my voice, let the world know that Jesus saves. I'm gonna keep on marching for you. I'm gonna keep on fighting. I'm gonna keep on lifting my voice and let the world know that Jesus saves. So many lonely people all over the world. The blessed words of Jesus. I am never hurt if I don't go.
Jesus, stay.
Church. Brad was asking if they were service animals.
Yes.
Jane said yes, they're therapy buddies.
Yes.
Both, right.
Well, anyway, praise the Lord. Well, I don't know if you got anything out of this morning or not. Probably you did, since you're here tonight. And what a blessing, what a good word from the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm so interested that Ben's been around a little too long. He said, all these evangelists get around to Acts chapter 2. And I said, well, brother, to be honest with you, Saturday night we were preaching over at the gathering. Our last scripture was Acts chapter 2. That's because, man, that's groundbreaking stuff. And it applies to us. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Would you give the Johnson family a warm welcome back to the classroom here in North Carolina? Amen.
Praise the Lord. Well, I'm excited that you're here tonight, because it's a lot more fun to sing to and minister to a crowd, to those that have come. No, we're just excited. I believe that this is Super Sunday, because, you know, David said this. He said, I was glad when they said unto me, it's time to go to church. That's the paraphrased version. But he said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Isn't that great? And I'm excited too, every opportunity. And I say that knowing that we're going to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning for prayer. Will that scripture come to my mind at 5:30? I was glad when they said unto me. But I want to tell you something. There's a lot of things that I've done in my life that I regretted afterwards. But I want to tell you that I have never, ever, 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 never, ever, ever spent time in prayer and got up and said, well, that was a waste of time. I never, ever have I done that. It's always sweet and always good that I can always say, that was good, God. That was good. Praise the Lord. Well, hey, let's sing this evening. I love to sing about heaven. Let's sing about going there, all right? We'll go all the way to heaven. 1, 2, 3. You wanna hear him sing? good and faithful servant. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And what Jesus wants to hear from us is yes. Yes, Lord, I will. I believe that's what God wants to hear from us. And then, you know what? I want to do this tonight. I just want to be relaxed, and I hope that you're relaxed. Not that we're trying to create that kind of an atmosphere that we're talking about, making everybody feel comfortable. That's not what I'm after, Pastor. But yeah, it's just a Sunday evening, and we're in the house of God, and we just should be relaxed. And well, let's do this, all right? Jubilee, I'd like for you to sing a few low parts, all right? I think we've done this before, but Jubilee, I just like it. And so would you just go ahead and you can take Matthias's parts if you want. Just sing some bass, all right? Hit a few real low notes. I think that you've got it in you. And let's do this together, all right? You got this, Jubilee?
Whatever you say, Dad.
Doesn't every parent love it when their kids say that? Whatever you say, Dad. But that's what God wants to hear from us as well. Whatever you say, Heavenly Father. Let's sing it, all right? Come on. Here we go. We've actually had people come to Jubilee after the service and say, girl, you have got such a range. Jubilee, I want you to go ahead and hit a few high notes this time if you would, but I want you to sing Grow, okay? And you know, I love to speak with the kids about, growing. You know, the Johnsons aren't real good at that, except for Micah. But you know... I've never been real good at growing, but I'm working on it, aren't I? But here, Jubilee, what God asks of us is that we grow in God's grace every day. So God wants us to grow. He wants us to grow in grace. He wants us to grow in the knowledge of Him. He wants us to grow in the knowledge of His Word. And we can grow. Isn't that something that is so special about the Word of God? That we can read it for a lifetime and continue to gain from it? Well, I tell you what, that must be why they call it the Living Word. Because, wow, you can study it for a lifetime and continue to grow. And without it, there is no growth. So, Jubilee, I know that this song says this. It says that other people come along and they say things like, You've got to try things out in the world, or you've got to sow your wild oats before you really know what you want to be or what you want to do with your life. But Jubilee, this song says, I'm going to shut them out. I'm going to shut out those voices. And that's certainly what we want you to do in your life, Jubilee. So come on and sing it. Grow. Sing it. You know, one time the kids made a falter or mistake on one night, and I've never liked inside jokes, so I said publicly, I said, well, you guys made a bit of a mistake there, so I'm not going to pay you your dollar. People felt...
And I've never liked...
And I thought it was really sweet to hear that Tim and Angela had done similar on a countdown to your wedding. Yeah. And that was really cool. That, you know, when Sandy and I married 20 years ago, then really it was more than just the two of us marrying, but it was styles. I don't know if you know this, but Sandy was raised doing 8 years, I think, of Royal Conservatory music. And so up to grade 8 on Royal Conservatory on the piano. And then she married somebody with born with a banjo on his knee, right? And so it wasn't really too awfully long after Sandy and I were married, and we were traveling with my mom and dad, and we were locked up in a church in a snowstorm up in Montana, and locked up there in Great Falls. And Sandy and I sat down, bored as can be, we sat down at the piano, and we kind of married those styles. And Sandy said, Ben, do you think that you could play something classical on the banjo? and her Royal Conservatory side coming out. And so we sat down and we wrote the Marriage Supper of the Lamb, and we've played it here before, but yet this past year we took it back to the recording studio and we asked the engineer to just help us out with it, and he said, well, what you need is a real orchestra. And God blessed us with being able to use this man from Nashville. He plays fiddle for Alan Jackson. He's a wonderful Christian man. And so he took our track and he just added viola and cello and all that sweet stuff. And so, but we wrote this song together, just marrying those styles and opposites attract, I guess, huh?
Yeah.
And yet we just want our, you know, we stand up here on stage and we want everything that we've got to be a witness to Jesus and how things can stay together and hold together when Jesus Christ is in the center. When we were dating, I remember I wrote a note to Sandy about excited that she's going to be my bride, and I, you know, I wrote her this whole long poem. But towards the end of the poem, I said this. I can't remember word for word anymore what it said, but I said, as strange as this may sound, one day I too am going to be the bride. And we went into talking about the marriage supper of the Lamb and how I can be excited, nothing weird about it, but just that part of the bride of Christ and excited to sit down at the marriage supper of the Lamb with Jesus. Amen. Let's sing it together, guys. Marriage supper of the Lamb.
Why?
serve a God who is alive. He hears us when we pray. His arm is not short for a touch or for healing. Get your electric on, all right, buddy? And, you know, I'm so grateful for the times in my life that I have seen God move. I have seen God do miracles. I'll never forget, even as a child, I remember watching, I was in his Pentecostal church in Central California, and Sunday morning, this lady, she came to the altar. She came with crutches, she came with a cast, and I can picture it in my mind exactly how it happened. And she walked up, people gathered around her and began to pray, lay hands on her, and I remember that the crutches went flying two different ways. She just shot them out from underneath her arms, and she did a jig. I don't know if it was a Pentecostal jig or just what, but she danced all over that foot. And I remember, just even as a child, just watching this take place and just saying, wow, God is so real. What he's done, what he's just, and I remember the lady coming back that night, having the cast off, and just walking into church and giving God all the glory. Amen. He is a healer. He truly is a healer. When Sandy was a little girl, she tells the story. I didn't know her well back then, but that Steve, my father-in-law, broke his arm, and he went to the hospital. He got a cast, and Sandy came along, and she said, "Daddy, let me pray." And he said, "Yes, honey, you pray for my arm." And so she prayed this real simple child faith prayer over Dad's arm. And then she went away, and Dad thought, well, that isn't that sweet. Sandy came back with a pair of scissors and said, "Cut it off, Dad." And Dad thought to himself, "What am I going to do? I've just got this thing put on today. The doctor tells me my arm was broken. But if I tell my daughter it doesn't work like that, honey, then what am I teaching my daughter?" And so Steve, my father-in-law, he took the scissors out of Sandy's hand, and he wet that thing down, and he cut that thing off, and he said, "And Ben, my arm was healed." He took that step of faith. God still works that way. To Sandy says, as a child, she just thought, well, I just thought that's the way it worked. That's right, brother, and that is just a step of faith. There's a reason why Jesus said, unless we become like little children, we might not even see heaven. Wow. Come on, guys, let's come and sing.
Men from a village in the land of Galilee suffered from a sickness for 12 years. She spent a lot of money on the doctors of that day. It seems all hope for her had disappeared. She heard the man of miracles was passing by. By the multitudes he was concealed. If I can only reach and touch the hem of his robe, maybe I can finally be healed.
Deaf and hear, if you can talk, the blind can see, and the lame can walk. Walked on water, calmed the sea, and raised the dead. Heal the sick and weak, the young boy was lunch. 5,000 men were fed. But in my certain circumstance, I'm reaching out to take a chance. If you reach down with loving arms and hear my plea, I hope this man of miracles has another miracle for me.
Troubles in my life, I've wondered if my Savior really cares. When the burdens that I carry seem to have no end in sight, I question if He even hears my prayers. Then I think of all the miracles that He has done, victories I barely can conceive. Even now, the work in my life Jesus has begun, brings me to a point I can't be.
Cause the deaf can hear,
Using this Dorcas character, and I can't believe how popular this character has gotten. We once had a Facebook page for him, but somebody was hard on that. They kind of hacked into that Facebook page and ruined Dorcas. But we can learn from these simple things, and sometimes you know the gospel is not complicated. And I think we pay theologians way too much money to make simple things complicated. But the gospel is really simple. It really is. And the whole plan of salvation is just tremendous. And I want to show you something tonight. Dorcas, why don't you come and, yeah, bring some, is that what you're supposed to bring? Dorcas, we had talked about this a little bit. Dorcas, I'm not sure here. Okay, you want me to take something from you? All right, here. What are you going to do here? Set it there on the table. Let's see what you got in mind here. Chocolate, and you got yourself some chocolate and some milk and a clear glass. Hey, it looks to me like you're planning to make some chocolate milk. All right, Dorcas, do you even know how to make chocolate milk? I didn't think so. It's kind of like asking somebody, do you know how to boil water? But we're talking about Dorcas here. Okay, so Dorcas, listen, we got a clear glass. And you think you can figure this out? All right, well, you just go ahead and you can make yourself some chocolate milk then, all right? Because, you know, we're talking about simple things, and these are truly just, you know, they're simple things. The gospel is simple, and Dorcas, I think you can figure this out. What are you doing? This is not how you do it. That's not how you do it. No. Listen, Dorcas, no, this isn't good. No, that's not even good for grandmas to say things like that. Because, okay, listen, that's not the way that you're going to do it, all right? You take the milk and you put it in the glass and, you know, keep it down a little ways. Leave yourself a little room for the chocolate. There you go. Put some milk in there. Yeah, put it in there. All right, because I believe we've got something special that you think we're just doing something silly. That's good. There you go. And now you need to put the chocolate in, all right? You know, when we receive Jesus in our life, then we receive the Spirit of Christ. I mean, we receive the Spirit of adoption. We receive Jesus into our life, and we get all the power and the authority that comes along with knowing Jesus. And when we receive Jesus, we receive His Spirit, and we receive a Spirit that leads us. Well, all right. We receive the Spirit from God, and it's good, and it's so good. And I think a lot of times that what happens is that people they receive the Spirit and they don't really understand what they've got to receive Jesus, because with Jesus comes power and authority. All right, so what are you doing, Dorcas? I think you got enough in there. No, you got enough. That's all right. You that's got it. Okay. No. You don't think it tastes very good, but that's because you don't realize what you've got. No. Listen. You don't need any more chocolate. Tell me about it. You don't need any more chocolate. Now, just a minute. Do you think that you have chocolate milk here? Do you think that he's got chocolate milk? He does not have chocolate milk. I want you to understand something. He doesn't have chocolate milk. You don't have chocolate milk. I know there's chocolate and there's milk, but you do not have chocolate milk. You have chocolate in your milk. You've got chocolate in your milk, but you don't have chocolate milk. You've got chocolate inside of your milk, but you don't have chocolate milk yet. I wonder if you're starting to catch on to what I'm saying. You don't have chocolate milk. You've got chocolate in your milk. And God says to us through his word that we need to do something with this. You taste it and it's like, yeah, it's good, but it's not what I expected, right? But this is what God calls us to do. You take this thing right here. Go ahead and grab a hold of that thing. Put it in there. And this is what it tells us. Stir it up. Get it stirred up. Come on, stir it up there, Dorcas. That's right. Because you didn't have chocolate milk before. Now you see. You're seeing what's taking place here. See, a lot of times people receive Jesus, and I believe what they've got is chocolate in their milk. They've got this chocolate in their milk. And yet they're like, well, I don't know. It's not working for me, this Jesus thing. They've got chocolate in their milk when you receive Jesus, but we need to stir it up. When we receive Jesus, we receive the Spirit of God. But then we need to stir up the Spirit. And then look at that. Wow, now that looks like some pretty rich. And it looks to me like the spoon could just about stand up in there by itself. All right, so Dorcas, what have you got now? Yeah, now you're pretty happy. Now that's some chocolate milk, huh? Boy, that's some pretty, that's some thick chocolate milk right there. You could probably patent that. And so, yeah, there you go. And now, isn't that sweet, Dorcas? Yeah. It's pretty sweet. Dorcas, you're probably not going to sleep tonight, are you? No. Well, you'll get lots accomplished, all right? Well, so Dorcas, let's... No. Listen, I think you better just learn to use what you got here, all right? Listen, this is what you need to do. You need to stir it up. And the Spirit within us needs a stir. Because you know what? I don't want to live my life with just chocolate in my milk. Because what God has given me is good and it is sweet. But Dorcas, it needs to be stirred up, all right? So you stir up that Spirit that is within you, and you stir up the Holy Spirit within you, and you'll see it is so much better. Now you've got yourself some chocolate milk there. All right, well, you have a good night, Dorcas, because it's going to be a long, exciting one for you, I think. All right, Pastor, why don't you come? I'm going to ask you to follow that act, if that's all right with you.
Brother Ben didn't mention too much, but this movie these guys have made is really good, all right? You need to pick up a copy. Took them how long? Well, Dorcas is up. But 2 years, and almost a year of editing and putting everything together, and it has a great message. And so I want to really encourage you to go back to that table. I keep their music in my car at all times, and it'll get you where you need to go, let me tell you. And so it's a wonderful thing. I just can't get Dorcas out of my head right now. She's going to think about that chocolate milk all night long. It's like, we're going to take up our offering this evening, and I'm going to ask the ushers if you come and bless this family. Where are you headed next? Surprise, surprise. And
I got two more guys.
Huh? Oh, Brother Grammer? You going to see Brother Grammer? Oh, good.
I got two more.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Any checks you've got, please make them out to North Valley Assembly. Praise the Lord. Well, you're a quiet bunch. Put on the happy face. They're dead. What did you do to them? We lost them at the stirring it up. Yeah, we need a little stirring up in here tonight. Hallelujah. God is good. He's going to bless you for giving. You know, I tire of television evangelists and so forth trying to suck money out of you. and that kind of thing. But here, friends, because you only know what the television camera shows you, right? I mean, all television is a little bit of a fib, because they only give you so much scope. And so you get what you see, or what has been made for you to see. But tonight, we're kind of wide open, aren't we? You can tell what kind of people these are. You can tell their passion and desire to serve Jesus. And one of the great parts of this ministry, as Brother Ben alluded to this morning, is taking the gospel to a most wonderful group of people, and that is children. If we forget to evangelize our children, we're going to end up in a mess in a few years, right? But what a great calling. We're to be faithful to that call. Would you bow your heads? Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you'd help us to support this ministry as we talk to you, that would bring glory to your name. Hallelujah. That the Johnsons might be able to relax in you and to know that you're faithful and that you still do miracles today. Hallelujah. I pray, Lord God, that you just have your way, continue to have your way this evening. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come on, Tim. Thank you very much for your giving. When we go anywhere, we travel by faith. You know what we have found? God is faithful. I'm sure glad I have never set a price and said, we'll come for this amount of money. Because God has shown to me, boy, if I would have done that, I'd have ripped myself off. No, God is good and faithful. So praise the Lord. Thank you for that. Yeah, there's stuff on the table back there, but I don't like commercials. There's the movie. We've got a couple extra radio broadcasts this year, volume 5 and 6. And people often say, well, what are those things exactly? And they're not singing CDs. There's 6 broadcasts on every one of those children's radio broadcast. There's 6 volumes back there with 6 broadcasts on every one, so 36 of them back there, and they're each 10 minutes long, and so each CD has a whole hour of listening. But you know what are they exactly? They're great tools for kids, for teaching the children the truths of God's word, the stories in God's word, and that they're so much more than just stories. And the CDs are done, those broadcasts are done like a Focus on the Family's Odyssey. They're done like in skits and stories, and they're just a lot of fun to listen to. Background music, background sound effects, guaranteed to make you laugh, or your kids laugh, or your money back, if you can find us. Let's sing the Lord Jesus.
You are. All
right, well, those on the back table, you know, the only people always want to ask us, how do you guys make it? I love that question, because the answer is God. And so the only way that we make money making these broadcasts, it takes us probably 2 hours for every 60 seconds of broadcasting time to record these and edit it. And so it's roughly 20 hours for every single 10-minute broadcast. But God has just exploded it. Right now we send them into Bible Voice Broadcasting, and then Bible Voice Broadcasting sends them all over the world, not on the internet either. They go directly to the radio stations. They're being played in radio stations in 5 different countries right now, and mostly in Africa, but one in Jerusalem, Bethlehem area as well. In the country of Kenya, it's every single Christian radio station in the whole country is playing those. So they're being played once a week. And so they're pressuring us. They're saying, well, can you please send us enough broadcasts so that we could do it 3 times a week and then eventually once a day? Well, we got 36 on the back table. We need 365, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But we're just going to keep putting them out as fast as we can. It's a never-ending story. The truth of God's word, his love for people, his love for those around the world. They're his people. They bleed red. They have life in them, and God loves them, and so we want to minister to them. So, yeah, that's in a nutshell what God is doing. And time fails me to be able to tell you how it all came to pass. But honestly, I'll tell you this: in a short version, on my very first ministry opportunity outside of my parents, I worked for a pastor, and within 1 year, as just such a young man, within 1 year, I kind of got at odds with that pastor. Being transparent with you tonight, and So his name was Norm Bonk. Got kind of at odds with him. Well, when it came time to, it looked like we would take this ministry and travel full time with it, I felt like God spoke to my heart and said, Ben, maybe you think you're gifted or you can play a few instruments or sing, but you're not ready to take the leadership of this ministry. And he spoke to my heart about go and make your heart right with your brother. So I went and found Brother Norm Bonk in this nearby city he was living in at the time. I found him. I made my heart right. And right afterward, things just began to explode with this radio broadcast. One day I called at the radio broadcast distributors, and I said to them, I said, so are we still on the air, or do you need more? And the lady said to me, Ben, do you not know? You're on such and such a radio broadcast. There's 7 million listeners. I was blown away. I thought, what? How is that possible? And then I stopped her and I'm like, wait a minute. But airtime costs money. Who's paying for our airtime? She laughed at me. She said, Ben, you don't know who's paying for your own airtime? I was embarrassed. And I said, no, I don't know who's paying for our airtime. And she said this to me way back in Toronto, and I'm out in Alberta at the time. And she said, have you ever met a man by the name of Norm Bonk? To this day, Norm Bonk's ministry, Debt of Love, pays for every minute of airtime all year long. For the past 6 or 7 years, he's done that. And he keeps expanding it as money comes in. Then he sends it to more radio broadcasts. So let me share you God's math. I made my heart right with one man. And as of today, 20 million people hear the gospel every single week. That's God's math. Amen. That's God's math. Lord Jesus, you are the one that I love.
Back in the days that I could hear the lion's roar.